Okay, good morning, everybody. Welcome to our webinar on filling empty spaces. I'm Trish Taylor from Life Retreats, and our focus is on wellness and mindfulness in the workplace. It's an honor to host this webinar with the PBF and our esteemed guests and government officials. Firstly, I would like to hand over to Sipho from the PBF, who will briefly introduce us. And then we'll continue to inspire you with filling empty spaces. Sipho, may I hand over to you?
Thank you, Trish. Welcome, everyone. Welcome, MEC of Infrastructure Development and Property Management, Ms. Tasneem Motara. Let me also welcome Ari, Paul. Thank you, Trish. Before I outline what is PBF all about, we want to show you the video about the PBF, and then I'll talk a little bit about the PBF.
The National Executive Committee declares the theme for 2021 to be unity, renewal, and reconstruction in the year of Charlotte McClurg.
The past year has been challenging for all of us. The coronavirus and its impact has been felt the world over. But the strength of the South African people has always been measured by its resilience and fortitude, and the willingness to unite and stand together. The African National Congress proudly presents the Progressive Business Forum, the platform to herald a new dawn for the South African economy. Bringing accountability, transparency, and opportunity to the business community, and striving to give effect to the call for a social compact with business, the Progressive Business Forum harnesses the power of technology, making it easier than ever before to unlock your business's potential. As a truly inclusive portal for all, your inputs are now able to reach the highest level of attention of our ANC leadership and government leaders, connecting you to an economic hub bursting with possibilities. It's a new modern look, underpinned by a traditional set of values that puts you, our subscribers, first. So, how can you be a part of it? Simple. Sign in, enter your business's details, and choose the package that best represents your company's goals. Our platform is safe, easy to use, POPIA compliant, and joining gains you access to a galaxy of benefits. From exclusive ministerial networking events to world-class webinars, workshops, skills training, trade facilitation, women in business, and so much more, the Progressive Business Forum platform becomes your gateway to a future never dreamed possible. Together, let's resolve the challenges facing our country and build a prosperous future. South Africa is ready to grow. Are you?
The forum was created to create a platform for both business and the ANC leaders and the leaders of the ANC government to engage. The Progressive Business Forum organizes events for networking purposes. We also arrange training for our subscribers. We have subscribers from small business, medium type of business, and big corporates who are part of our subscribers. So what we usually do, we will create a platform for our subscribers on topical issues. Last time, we allowed our subscribers to make an input into the ANC Economic Reconstruction and Recovery Plan. And the inputs were able to be included in the final document. We also organized the webinar. Today's webinar that we'll be focusing on the space management, which include key players, is one of the programs that we're focusing on. We also create opportunities for subscribers. They also participate in international programs. We have trade missions that we arrange for our subscribers. What is critical for our subscribers in the PBF is to give them an opportunity to also influence ANC policies, particularly on the economic policies, because big business wants to know how government is planning and what are the things that government are working towards. So that is a program of Progressive Business Forum for small and big business. Today's program, it also talks to the thinking of government around the spatial planning. If you look at the special development framework of government, it talks to people must work, must live where they work and play. And that is very important. The COVID has provided us with an opportunity to think outside the box. That's why today's PBF, we felt it would be critical to have this conversation. On that note, let me hand over to Trish. Thank you, Trish.
Okay, filling empty spaces is indeed a hot topic due to the COVID crisis. Many business premises are sitting empty with rentals having dried up for landlords. But all is not lost, as there are numerous new business opportunities out there just waiting to be discovered and explored. At times of crisis, it is easy for us to become anxious and overwhelmed, which limits our cognitive abilities, making us less likely to think out of the box. I invite you all to sit back for the next hour, relax, and let your imagination go wild while we listen to and interact with our experts. Not only have they thought out of the box, but they have already put it into practice and have incredible success stories to share. We encourage interaction and questions so that in our chat box, we will interact with you. Please feel free to just write any questions you may have. With that said, I would like to hand over and introduce you to Tasneem Motara from the Gauteng Department of Infrastructure and Development. Thank you very much for joining us, Tasneem, and I'll hand over to you.
Thanks. Morning, Trish, and morning to the colleagues, both from the Progressive Business Forum, as well as the fellow panelists today. And thank you very much for inviting me and including me in this webinar, really on a topical issue about how we use the space that has almost become obsolete just because of COVID, and how we repurpose and reuse the space, given the fact that we still have other priorities and other stresses and other challenges that we need to be able to resolve. So let me just speak for just a few seconds about the department. And the department is really what would be known in public sector as public works. So our responsibility really is the management of government immovable assets. So that's property and built structures. And that's the management from purchasing right up to managing its entire lifespan, right up until disposal of government assets. And government assets in the immovable space would include land, would include properties such as schools, hospitals, clinics, as well as road infrastructure. And then, of course, we make available spaces for public use through public-private partnerships. And then we also want to be able to explore making use of our spaces and properties for private use. And I'll speak a little bit about that in as we go on. So given that, that's really the responsibility of the department. Part of that responsibility obviously then means that we've got to be able to answer the questions about spatial development and our spatial planning. Over the past possibly 20 years post-apartheid, much of the spatial planning has kept the apartheid spatial planning intact. And I think it still is, it's very much, we're very much able to see it in the way people commute, passengers commute from work to home every day, how people commute from work to school every day. And that has always, and that has also lent itself to a change in some of the policies. So for example, some of the policies in the housing or human settlements, as it is now called, was once upon a time called housing. And it was really just about putting up housing structures, not with the settlement aspect of it and developing developing cities or developing communities. And then policy shifts and policy changes would have taken place. And we now have human settlements where if you are developing a housing development, it has to be accompanied with services that ultimately will lend itself to economic opportunity, as well as education and health and other recreational services. So we now look at holistic sort of development to be able to respond to the challenges, as opposed to just working in silos. And then, of course, the government ourselves, we own a lot of properties that are used, for example, as office spaces. One of the biggest office spaces accommodation that we have would be the National Public Workspaces that is accommodated in Pretoria, that I think we're all familiar with, just all the head offices of national departments. And similarly, the provincial government has got head office spaces in the Johannesburg CBD. And we have taken a conscious decision to remain in the CBD because should we move out of the CBD, we would also add to the dereliction that goes on in CBDs as a result of economic opportunities shifting out of the CBD. CBDs are no longer the central business districts that they were and have now begun to become other districts and other sort of spaces. So you find that in the former, what we know as CBDs, they now have spaces of education, higher education in particular. They also have mixed use accommodation for housing. And that lends itself to the sort of city life that has changed over time. And of course, government policy and government decisions about where we make investments has also got to couple and has also got to accept the changing nature of movement and the way our communities are evolving. So we've gone through a rigorous process of just wanting to also add to the regeneration of the CBDs. Knowing that, and of course, COVID has really asked the big question, is office space really such an important feature? I mean, businesses now can work with a workforce offsite. You can work remotely. You can literally work from wherever you are, the comfort of your home, yet be quite productive. And so the question is, what do we then do with our spaces? So some of the things that we're looking at is to be able to make accommodation, make our spaces available for accommodation, but also not just accommodation, also for businesses. So if you were to really revamp a 15-story building, you could possibly put recreation in the same building, as well as healthcare, as well as entertainment, as well as human settlements. And I think if we look at, for example, the French example, where the buildings in the French suburb, the Paris city of Paris, a building would be many things at once. So you would be able to go to school, you would be able to go to a restaurant, you would be able to go to a gym, you would also get healthcare, you would also live in a building. And at some point there could often be office space. And of course that just is about making sure that where you live is where you play, is where you go to school, is where you're not forced to have to travel long distances to be able to get services, which should really be at your fingertips. Of course, COVID has given us an opportunity to be able to relook at how we use space, at how we develop space so that they're not rigid, how we develop spaces and how we develop even spaces for future purposing and repurposing. We've done quite a lot of that in our response to COVID with what we've done in the hospitals, having refurbished about 10 of our hospitals and then used alternative building technology to be able to put up new structures in a very, very short space of time. So what ordinarily would have taken us 2 to 3 years to build, it has taken us about 4 to 5 months cumulatively, if we count the work days and work hours, to be able to put up huge, magnificent structures. But the point about these structures is that they're not rigid and that we could actually, and we will definitely, repurpose them for future use. They can be, in a very short space of time, remodeled to be anything really. They're hospitals today, high care facilities, but they could be universities tomorrow. And I think that's what we need to be able to look at, is are we using our space effectively? Are we using it efficiently? And do we have a futuristic approach to the way we use our spaces and our living spaces? Of course, the way we live today, people have changed over a very big, long period of time. Possibly 20 to 30 years ago, people were looking for big spaces houses with big space. Of course, given the fact that many of us now spend a lot of time out of home, you lock up and go, you need something that's safe and secure, and space has now become smaller and people want security as opposed to space. And then with the advent of COVID, people will relook at what is the ideal type of space that they will live and work in. And of course, we know that COVID will be with us for a very, very long time. And it has given us an opportunity to look at what could be the new normal. But also, if we look at what is the new normal, how do we then prepare for any other pandemic that might befall us, whether it be a health pandemic, whether it might be a natural pandemic. I mean, if you look at just our weather pattern in Gauteng over this period, we've had more rain in this period than we've had in a very, very long time. And that, of course, following very dry seasons and droughts out in the Cape. So those are some of the things that we need to be able to consider and take into consideration when we look at how we use the space that's available to us. Of course, noting that space is not, the space gets filled, and once space gets filled, you run out of space. So we've got to be able to use it effectively and efficiently. And that's what we intend to do. That's what we've begun to do. And of course, we are happy to look at what the private sector has in terms of development and research, because they could also be far ahead in terms of what could possibly work for government to be able to respond to. And platforms such as these give us an opportunity to look at what the private sector is doing and currently doing, and what are they looking at, so that our policies and policy position and even our spending is geared towards supporting those and responding to those. Thank you so much.
Wow, Tasneem, thank you so much. That was so inspiring and so interesting to listen to. It almost makes me feel like COVID could be the answer to many of South Africa's questions if we find the correct solutions. You know, being able to use space that's actually been wasted, a lot of it for a long time, just makes so much sense. So thank you so much. I'm sure there will be questions for you, if you're okay to just stay online and answer them later on. And I am going to hand over to Paul and Ari from the Egg Project, because they have already put into practice the most exciting concept, and they'll tell you all about it. So welcome, guys. I'm in awe of you, and I'm sure everybody else will be off.
First of all, thank you. I just want to take the opportunity of thanking everyone concerned for inviting us to be on this panel and share some of our visions, both currently and for the future. If we get to inspire just one person today, then I think that would be a success. Just a little bit about myself. I know that Aria will obviously introduce himself. I consider myself a serial entrepreneur. I started my first business at the age of 21. I started a business called YDE, or Young Designers Emporium. It was a platform for South African fashion designers within the South African context. And I sold that business in 2010 to Truewords, and subsequently have had a number of businesses, startup businesses, since then. But the latest, and I might add greatest, is our egg platform that both Ari and I, who are lifelong friends, have only established. We launched on the 1st of December. I think that, you know, the topic for today being empty spaces was just so appropriate effectively for what we've done. I think there's no question that both public and private sector are in challenging times. I think everyone will agree that the current landscape is unprecedented and challenging. But as Tasneem alluded to a number of times, I think that certainly for me as an entrepreneur, it's times like this that one can really find new ways of doing things. And I think, often say to people, you know, the definition of insanity is doing the same thing over and over again and expecting a different result. And there's no question that when one looks at spaces, as I say, whether they be in the public or private sector, one needs to rethink the use of those spaces. So it's fantastic that initiatives like this and what Tasneem was saying in terms of what government is doing to address this. So as two maverick entrepreneurs, another word that Tasneem used quite a lot was partnership. And Ari and I have also unprecedented partnered with Old Mutual Properties to bring and birth the concept of Egg, which we're going to do a presentation and explain what it is. But effectively, Egg is a platform for mainly SMEs, whereby they may not otherwise have had access to, you know, A-grade shopping space for a whole lot of reasons. And we will go into that in our presentation. But perhaps maybe, Aria, you just want to introduce yourself and then we can start the presentation.
Yeah. Hi, everybody. Firstly, a real privilege to be able to speak in this forum, and thank you to everybody for this. Yeah, I think space is a very topical issue, especially with the acceleration of how is space being utilized in a time of COVID. So I just saw one of the questions that was already posted is, can you turn residential into commercial, or can you turn commercial into residential? I think the usage of space is absolutely relevant. And what we have done in partnership with Old Mutual Properties is looked at space that came available. So just to give you a little bit of a history, Edgar's was the initial space where we've started. And as you know, Edgar's was in its heyday, one of the biggest retailers in South Africa, actually the biggest retailer in South Africa. And unfortunately, because they did not pivot and they did not transform their business model, they have not been able to sustain. What we've done completely differently and turned it on its head and really thought out the box is to offer a platform which we have currently 247 SMEs, brands, entrepreneurs on our platform. And just to say the point about entrepreneurship, just to give you a quick history of what I've done, my father started in 1978 an iconic brand called Fabiani, which we were really, I was at from a very, very young age taught that the customer is everything and customer service is everything and the experience that goes with customer service. And I got involved in the business in the late 90s and we opened up stores all around the country. And really one of our big focuses was to serve the customer and make the customer feel special. And when they left with whatever they purchased, besides looking good, was that they actually felt good. And I think that's really part of Paul and I's DNA. And I think the customer in South Africa really deserves to feel special, not only from the service level, but from an experience point of view. And that we'll take you through in Egg. And what we did with Fabiani was, and this is something very interesting from a South African context point of view, we are always looking for up north as the people that are the leaders, but we can create amazing brands in this country. Fabiani was created and birthed in South Africa, obviously with its very strong Italian provenance, and then landed up being sold to the Foschini Group. Currently today, it's the most profitable and fastest growing brand within the Foschini Group portfolio. We also brought in G-Star Raw into the country, which we created as an iconic denimwear brand among the customers of South Africa. And that has also been reversed into the Foschini Group. And then I worked for 5 years at the Foschini Group. And what was an interesting point about space, and as I was thinking as you're speaking, Tasneem, was that the Foschini Group always had a view of, with all their brands at the head, was to be constantly increasing space and not really looking at what are the dynamics. And most recently, and I just want to mention this on this forum, there is a great example of what the Foschini Group did about a year ago about offering an experience. I'm not sure how many of the people on the call have been to the sports scene in Sandton City, where they have a basketball court, a music studio, you can have a tattoo done, you can have your sneakers cleaned. And they really evolved their space. But these big companies don't really have the ability to actually execute it on a consistent level. And what you'll see when we go into Egg now is that we are offering all of these experiences wrapped up with allowing a platform for all of our SMEs to thrive, not only survive, but also thrive. So on that note, I'm going to share a screen and Paul is going to take you through the journey of We Are Egg.
Right. So both Ari and myself have alluded to who we are. But really what we're envisaging a new collaborative approach which supports all stakeholders in retail. So Ari, if you can go back to the next one.
Yeah, wait. Must go up, down.
Down again. Sorry, apologies, guys. Ari and I are not together. No, you've gone past the slide.
One second, there's something wrong.
Apologies, everyone. Okay, can start from here, Ari. It's fine.
Okay.
So welcome to Egg.
One second. Sorry, everybody. It's just not operating how I would like it to operate. Okay.
Thanks, Aria. I hope that everyone enjoyed that. So what was our vision for this? Our vision was to redefine and redesign the traditional retail landscape by democratizing it. And I think it's important here for me to just set the picture of what it would be like for, prior to us launching Egg, what it was like for an SME. So invariably, there was just too much red tape. An example would be, let's say I created the most incredible knitwear. I was now selling thousands of units through Instagram, through Facebook. I was doing weekend markets, and I, as the entrepreneur, felt that I was ready to go into a mainstream, A-grade mall. Effectively, what would happen is there were just too many barriers to entry for that type of entrepreneur to get in. So a couple of things that I'll highlight that they would be faced with. They were normally a lease document that was often onerous and really very, very difficult for a new business owner or an SME to understand. They would then be faced with challenges of putting down large deposits, shop fitting to the landlord specification. So effectively, if you had a little business, you may require a couple of million rand in funding, which certainly in today's economy would be a challenge, but is a general challenge. And both Ari and I felt that I've known this for many, many years, right from our YDE days. There's an incredible amount of creative talent within South Africa. I've been very fortunate in my life where I've traveled overseas quite extensively. And very, very often I find myself standing overseas and thinking our product could very, very easily stand quite proudly, in fact, on a high street in London or New York. We seem to have a hangover as South Africans in terms of, something that is from overseas is always perceived to have more value. But I think that what goes to that is often, there hasn't been a platform for SMEs and entrepreneurs. And I think a lot of time, effort and money has been spent on entrepreneurship within South Africa. But one of the challenges that I've felt is these great courses, these great mentorship programs, but once they've gone through that process, there wasn't actually a platform for them to actually start the business. And hence the idea of creating a platform at Egg, whereby we create a world-class retail environment, but where it is accessible to SMEs. Aria, next slide. So Egg is not only a retail store, it's a platform for others to stand on, an ecosystem to thrive and grow, and a community that is stronger together. And I think that one of the things that, we spoke about taking positives out of COVID, and I couldn't agree more. One of the things that I think has made people, wake up to is that we are stronger together. I don't think businesses can work in silos anymore, even big businesses. I think that if one creates that word community on a number of levels, that is the future, whether it be retail, whether it be reimagining empty spaces, the fact that we are stronger together and as a community, and that may be something as simple as a public-private partnership, a partnership like Ari and I have done with Old Mutual. It could be on a number of levels, but an important one. So how does Egg do it? We've got three pillars. We want to co-create the future. We want to collab ideas, dreams, innovations, and aspirations. And we want to co-evolve together. And those are really the three pillars of Egg. So what makes Egg unique? Egg has the spirit of an independent, but the scale of a department store. So Egg is 3,000 square meters of retail space. The first one is open in Cavendish Square in Claremont, in the Western Cape. But the other part that makes it unique is that we're agile and responsive by nature, with broad access to new consumers and more traffic. So again, I alluded to the fact that SMEs up until the launch of Egg had almost been excluded for a number of reasons from high traffic football places. The fact that we are an agile model. So really what happens is, and the way our business model works is that an entrepreneur, we like to call them partners, comes on board and they have an indefinite period of time with us as long as they are happy and Egg is happy, but either party can exit that arrangement with 1 month's written notice. Now, I think that this is also, talk about positivities of COVID. That business model has obviously been accelerated by COVID. I think people are, for many reasons, would be hesitant to sign long leases. And this that gives them the ability where what Ari and I feel strongly about is a win-win scenario. If it's not win-win, I don't believe that a tenant or a partner should ever be tied into a lease if it's not viable. And that's one of the things that, makes our model agile. And then the other thing that our SMEs, partners, and entrepreneurs get by being part of Egg is independent expert curation from every part of you. So they not only have access to both the 25 or 30 years of retail experience that both myself and Aria has, but we are in the process of setting up networks where we will do mentorship programs, educational programs, entrepreneurial programs that they would have access to. So we have 250 of the best vendors, our categories within this. And if one thinks of a department store is effectively what this is, we have fashion and streetwear, beauty, sneakers and soles, wellness, jewelry and accessories, food and drink, and customization, as well as a whole lot of services. So within the Egg platform, we have hairdressers, we got men's barbers, we've got makeup studios, and this is all under one roof, which immediately is a differentiation in the current marketplace. So this was all made possible by, again, going back to the partnership, by a pioneering partnership between Egg and Old Mutual Properties. And, Old Mutual Properties own 50% of Egg. They have partnered with two maverick entrepreneurs like myself and Aria. And I need to say kudos to Old Mutual, a relatively conservative a company like Old Mutual to have the vision to look for something new. And when one talks about empty spaces, they didn't want to sit and say, look, we have empty spaces, the landscape is challenging. They looked for the correct partnership and both myself and Aria developed the Egg concept that they have partnered with us on. So I'm going to let Aria take you through this next slide. It is the flywheel, and this is really how a business model works. Aria, you want to take this one?
Okay. So just to talk all through with you about our pioneering partnership, because I think it's so critical. In today's times, we have to collaborate. And this is not only about collaborating with our tenants or partners inside the store, but this is actually about collaborating with the shopping center. And I just wanted to touch on one of the key points of this forum today being space. So obviously Old Mutual had the space and we had the concept and the retail experience and mistakes, might I add, to actually deliver the Egg platform. So I mentioned earlier that we took over an Edgar's existing site. So just to give you an idea of the scale of this business, it's 2,900 square meters of actually physical retail and 900 square meters of a warehouse which does replenishment for the floor, and we will be launching e-commerce from the warehouse, which means that we are actually a fully omni-channel business all under one roof, which is not only you've got your physical retail, but you've also got your e-commerce all under one roof. And again, that's a new use of space. Just for example, historically, e-commerce sits from a warehouse, and that's off-site, and then you would have your retail store sitting inside the shopping center, as well as a head office would be sitting off-site, and our head office also sits inside here. So we've got our full 360 degree of retail all under one roof at Cavendish Square in Cape Town. So how do we start? We first start with the process of curating. So for example, in streetwear and sneakers, we would curate, and we would go out and look for the best partners or entrepreneurs, brands to actually come into that area. For example, I was having an amazing phone call with one of our partners, which we are very proud to be involved with, called Seppo Jeans. And the phone call last night, late into the night, there Seppo is an entrepreneur coming home very, very late home. And we were talking about business and how and what is the challenge within the COVID environment. And his point was, well, you know, I really want to work out how Seppo Jeans can more integrate with the egg model, and how can we create a stronger relationship, and we can use the platform to showcase the full offering of Seppo Jeans. And we had a great strategy discussion last night, and we will be implementing a lot of strategies into the store, which will start the process of attracting. So our next point is, after curating each one of the areas from all of those eight categories which Paul ran you through earlier, is that it's a win-win business model. Now, let me just go through this win-win business model, because it's easier said than done. What the beauty about this business model is that the partner or entrepreneur or brand that comes in, they've only got a 30-day lease. And effectively, in that 30-day lease, they can pull out after 30 days, or we could pull. Ideally, we want to travel the full journey with them in egg. And for example, our lease in Cavendish is 7 years. So if the model is sustainable and is profitable, we want our partners to travel along the whole way. Now, why does the business model work? We provide the full retail science and retail execution for the partner. So what we call it, it's a plug and play model, which is point number three, which removes the barrier to entry. So effectively what happens is that the partner, all that the partner does is they put their product inside the store, we merchandise it, we pay for all the fixtures and fittings. We then merchandise it in accordance to how they would like their brand to be represented. Their brand gets a space to live in. It obviously lives in the category that's of retail that it plays in. And in turn, we have the salespeople to fulfill their sales of their business. And then they come to our till point. We also pay for the credit card charges. It also goes through our point of sale. So all the retail science and the execution of the 360 degree execution of retail, we actually as Egg do it. So what the partner or entrepreneur or brand has to just focus on is getting the best product into our store that we can deliver upon it. There are some anomalies to this model. For example, in the service business where we have food partners, we provide the full infrastructure for the food partner. But then normally what happens is the food partner has their own employees coming in and working in the space within Egg. And food has been exceptionally successful launch in Egg. Then also we have a hairdresser, a barber. You can also get your nails done. You can have ear piercing. We will certainly introduce in the future when COVID relaxes, a tattoo parlor. So all of these elements are, people are putting in the service provider in there to give the service of it. And that's the plug and play part. Then what we want to really do is to optimize the offering and ensure that it's in the correct space and give the service that it deserves with inside Egg. And again, is we've got magnetic pull. And why do we have magnetic pull? Is because we have this absolute amazing experience. And we will be taking you through a journey of the store in a couple more slides. But effectively, what we do is we attract the consumers, we attract the producers, we then attract the consumers, and then again, you attract the producers. So it becomes a self-fulfilling cycle. And in essence, just to kind of give you an idea of in physical retail, in challenging COVID times, we had 94,000 people through our doors in December. And the feedback is overwhelmingly, people absolutely loved it. They loved the experience. They loved the way that they were treated. And most importantly, they loved the content within Egg across all our categories of retail. And again, what we want to do in our flywheel is by using data, which I think is critical in analyzing space, is the data we use is what is the sales, what are our customers, our customer demographics, what they're made of, where's our catchment area. And we use all this data to become a matchmaker. And there again, we will capture and attract producers and consumers and then further attract more producers. Now, what's super exciting about this is that we've effectively curated and matchmaked already with 247 partners inside Egg in Cavendish Square. And this is constantly changing and we're constantly optimizing what the offering is. And again, if it's a win-win model, we want our partners to live along the journey. I think what's also super, super amazing about this concept is that when we come to Joburg, we believe that in the Gauteng area, we believe that we're going to be attracting a whole lot of new, super exciting partners in the space. And there'll be up to 250 partners then. We'll then be expanding it into Durban, into Gateway Shopping Mall, which is another old mutual center. Again, getting new partners and just exposing the unbelievable talent that exists within South Africa. Paul, do you want to take this one over?
Sorry, everyone. I was talking and I was muted. So we're a truly omni-channel approach. And for those of you that are not okay with omni-channel, omni-channel is when one does both the digital and the physical from one space. This is very much something that a lot of retailers are doing overseas. So we have a fulfillment center, as Ari alluded to, on site, whereby if a sale comes through an e-commerce platform or it comes or a customer is physically in the store, that sale doesn't matter. We can literally go from the warehouse upstairs, take that entrepreneur's, let's say it's a garment, off the floor, pick it, pack it, and send it for them. But one of the things that we're most excited about is the inclusion of technology. So we have are the first ones in South Africa, possibly Africa, but I know certainly for South Africa, to have something called beacon technology. Now, this is being used by some of the top retailers overseas, and effectively we've got beacons within our ceiling, and when one comes in, we're all aware that our devices are no longer just purely for communication. It's how we get our information. It's also how we shop. So when one walks into the Egg store, you'll be prompted to download our app. Once you have that app, you can then navigate right throughout the store. You can also get one of the things when we were researching this particular venture was that we found that in retail, there wasn't a story told behind it. You know, it was very difficult to convey the story of that particular brand to the consumer. So this will be launched from 1 March. Every one of our partners that are on our platform will have a QR code. You'll be able to take this app, scan the QR code, and get the story behind it. For example, there's a huge drive, which I'm very pleased about, towards local. I'm very proud to say that in excess of 80% of the product and partners within Egg are local. Now there's a huge trend towards buying local, but it's very difficult for a consumer to, you know, decide, is this a local product or is it not a local product? And by utilizing this app with a QR code, consumer will also be able to shop from their device while they're walking around the store, or even on the bus, train, or in their car on the way to the store, shop, and their bag will be waiting for them at a click and collect counter within the store. This, as I say, is how retail is already being conducted overseas, and we're very proud to be launching it. So when one talks about what's on offer for the entrepreneur, we realize that different businesses, particularly SMEs, are at different stages of their business cycle. So we have created environments within Egg where they can rent a 2.5 square meter space, a 5 square meter space, or a 10 square meter space. And obviously these spaces include both access to our e-commerce platform, the stockroom fulfillment center, but different brands have different needs. The beauty and the agility of our model is that a partner can really, really be doing exceptionally well. They start off in a 5 square meter, they can come to us and say, look, we think we'd like a 10 square meter space and vice versa. Someone might look at the viability and say, you know what, I can actually trade and get similar turnover, but I don't think I require the 5 square meter. Can I move to a 2.5 square meter? And that doesn't normally happen in a retail environment. So that's one of the reasons that makes our model agile. Ari, you want to go to the next one?
Okay, you just want to just run through this. This is just some of the imagery of the Egg brand. So you can just get the feeling of some of our launch imagery with inside the store. And also one of our sales consultants packing it up in a great Egg bag with some beautiful tissue paper.
So that is, we've really tried to reimagine retail on a number of levels. That image that you're seeing there is the shop front. So it's by no means a standard shop front. But one of the things that is exceptionally important, Ari, will you go to the next slide, just in terms of experiences. So the idea is that that's just post the entrance of the store. You walk in and you walk through arches. And it's absolutely imperative in this day and age, particularly in brick and mortar retail, to create an experience for the consumer. And why I say that is a lot of retailers are complaining and saying, look, e-commerce is cannibalizing the market. And the research that Ari and I did prior to opening this showed something quite differently to that. The information that we have showed that e-commerce actually works optimally with brick and mortar retail. So when the consumer has an opportunity to engage, that's actually driving e-com sales. A prime example would be Amazon overseas are now opening retail stores. Now that's purely an e-com platform. A local example here would be an e-com platform like Yuppie Chef, who are now moved into retail. But what's imperative, because we can all order pretty much anything from behind our computer, the exception of maybe having your hair done, your nails done, that kind of thing, you can pretty much order any product or service from behind your computer. So why would a consumer come to a brick and mortar store? And that word is customer journey and experience. And what this image shows you is these arches as you walk into our store. One has smell in it, one has sound in it, and one has visual. So it really is creating an experience as you walk in and appealing to all the senses of that consumer. This gives you an idea of one of our departments, our streetwear department. And as Aria said, we supply all fixtures and fittings for the brands, partners, SMEs. They literally just need to concentrate on what they're really good at, which is producing amazing product. These are, you will see that also the models, it's not Egg products. We are a platform for brands. So each of those signs that you see in the back there that gets put above the person's section, and that identifies them as to who the brand is. So they are actually buying from the brand. It's almost like their own store within a store. Again, giving you some insight into what the store looks like inside with fixtures and fittings. One of the areas that we're most excited about and has actually been exceptionally successful for us, although we're only in 2 months into our journey, is that we've created a customization bar within the store. And really what this is, we've divided up into three ways. So one is you can come in and bring any garment, bought at Egg or not, and get it printed within the store. So for example, I've had my daughter's names put on the back of a sweatshirt. You can take a peak cap and have your company's name on, and they will do that in the store for you while you wait. We then have a sneaker cleaning bar where we've got guys that have set up a business cleaning sneakers. And then the one that I'm most excited about, we've created almost a hot desk for local South African artists, and you can bring garments there. This is an example, and they will hand customize and paint for the consumer. And it's not just footwear. I actually have, my daughter plays the ukulele, and I had a ukulele customized last week. So really, really exciting. But again, something that you can't do through the computer, you can't do on e-commerce, and something unique to us. This is imagery of our wellness department. Again, you can see the different signs of the different brands that we have. As you walk into the store, we've got incredible fresh flowers, a coffee roastery, and this is one of our food partners, Schecter's Raw, that does a vegan offering and smoothies. So that's an image of as you walk in through those arches of the store where you see fresh flowers. It's in the wellness section and really becomes inviting for the consumer to come in. So this is a very interesting side, and I spoke earlier to creating experiences for the consumer, because as I say, I believe that if brick and mortar retailers want to survive, they need to pivot. And one of the ways they can pivot is to create experiences for consumers. And pretty much up until Egg, and I stand to be corrected, other than having the, you know, a woman frying sausages in a Pick and Pay, there was very little experience for the consumer. And what Ari and I have done and designed here, that it's actually the first that I've seen in the world, is create a center court right in the middle of the store. We've kitted the center court out with every kind of sound, lighting, and audio visual gizmo that may want. And this is added value to our partners. So for example, if you are one of our partners, and when we talk about democratizing retail, it doesn't matter if you are if you have the smallest space of 1.25, or if you have 20 square meter space, everyone has the same access to it. All you need to do to book this, there's no charge. It's part of what comes with the value proposition of being part of Egg. All you have to do is say to our marketing brand, this is the experience or the activation that I want to create for the consumer. And it's been, although a little bit challenging in COVID, we've had 5 events there so far. And I'll just briefly tell you about 2 of them. One is a local makeup brand called Switch. And it was unfortunate that it was so successful because it's COVID times, because we actually had to close the doors at one stage. It attracted 5,000 people, where they actually activated and engaged with their consumers for one of their new products that they wanted to launch. Another partner that we have in our accessory section is a brand called Sealin Gear. And they really make bags and accessories out of recycled yachting fabric. And what they did was they brought machinery into the center court, and a consumer just before Christmas could come and choose whichever panels of their fabric they wanted and have your own bag made up. So it was almost designed by you. So we believe that it's things like this and experiences that we're creating and a platform like this is what will make the difference between successful and unsuccessful brick and mortar retail. This is an example of a setup we did on the center court. As we've said, the store has both a hairdresser, a barber. This is an image of our jewelry section. Jewelry was obviously exceptionally successful over the December period. And the same process goes. So if you see like a glass cabinet there, that is what a partner is able to rent on a monthly basis. And to obviously exhibit. And we supply, as Aria said, all the associated retail services, the staff, the fixtures and fittings, as well as the retail sides. So this is our food area. Aria also mentioned very, very successful. Our food area, we've got 17 food vendors, everything from burgers to sushi, to bagels, to pizza, et cetera. We actually just launched a new pancake offering today. Again, challenging in COVID, but been exceptionally successful and well-received, our food offering. This is our beauty section. At the back, you can see a barber's pole. So that's where the men's barber is, and the hair salon. Again, you have got a great idea of the brands. You'll see Squirn's name up there, local South African cosmetic brand. That is our beauty offering.
There are a few questions now for you.
I'm very happy to answer if you've got time. Okay.
If you don't mind, can you see the questions on your screen?
I've got them. So I'll do the first one. Miranda, you're saying, for We Are Egg, from idea to opening doors, how long was the process? It's a very interesting question. Well, the question should be, how long should the process have been? But Ari and I had been working on this for probably about 18 months behind the scenes, but we effectively only got push go and did a partnership with Old Mutual literally 9 months prior to opening, which was challenging in itself in that that was our first lockdown. And we literally put this together within a 9 month period over lockdown. It was probably one of the most challenging and rewarding things that I've done in my life. Ideally, certainly for the next store, which is in Rosebank in Johannesburg, which is in September, we obviously have a lot of learnings, but have given ourselves more time.
So the second question, what's the split between local and international brands at Egg? Again, we've had a very, very strong focus on the talent that exists within South Africa. And one of the reasons and the providence of why we are so passionate about Egg is because it gives them the opportunity of a platform to really shine on. So we are about 80% local and 20% international brands. And we really believe that when the local brands sit next to the international brands, we can start feeling proud and believe that we can rise to and be of the same level as international brands. And Egg is that perfect platform to sit on top of.
What is the process of getting the brand into Egg? So there's a number of, but the easiest way to do is we've set up a www.weareegg.co.za. And on that landing page, there says partner application. So we call the people that brands that we partner with partners, and one can fill in all the details there. I'm also happy to give out my personal email address at paul@weareegg, if you would prefer to contact me directly.
Thanks, Paul. Can you put the website into the chat box so people can copy it, please?
Aria, people that want to go onto the website. While I answer the last question here.
Sure.
So it just says, I saw that there was seating at Egg for displays or demos. How does this get used by brands in store? So I'm not sure if that was pre or post me talking about the center court. The center court can literally be booked on an ad hoc basis. There's no charge for it by any of our brands or partners within Egg. And then that space is also available by brands that, you know, might want to utilize it for a launch or something that maybe perhaps aren't part of Egg, but then there's obviously a cost associated with it. As I say, it is, how can NGOs benefit from empty spaces? So, we engage with a number of upliftment programs. So I have tried to, in each category, give a space that doesn't attract any cost. In every category, and we've managed to do that in probably 8 out of the 10 categories. But I'm always open to looking at how NGOs could benefit from spaces within our store. So if you want to make contact with me, as I say, awesome. I'm happy to discuss that.
Thank you so much. And Tasneem, maybe also, are there possibilities with NGOs that you could maybe share a little bit of info on?
We do a lot of work with where NGOs need space and that sort of thing, where we do have facilities that would meet their requirements. It's just a process of them applying for it and then giving us their business model, as well as financials and the business case. So it's just about applying and then meeting the requirements. And then we do lease a lot of our properties and work with NGOs.
Awesome. Well, I think it's about time to wrap up, but I just want to thank you. Has anybody got any last words that they would like to add? It's been awe-inspiring.
I just wanted to say thank you for everyone that obviously joined the webinar, for the team for putting it together, and obviously for inviting Ari and myself to share We Are Egg with you. And looking forward to coming up to Johannesburg. I think most people on here are based in Johannesburg. So September, keep your eyes open.
Awesome.
And if there's anybody in the forum that would really like to get onto the Egg platform, I've just shared some of the details. We'd love to show you how the egg platform works, and really look forward to getting some great concepts that are definitely existing out there within South Africa.
Amazing. And Tasneem, do you have any last words to say?
No, just to say that I think for us, we're very keen to see how the build industry, especially the way space is being repurposed and remodeled, and the way it's going, because it also gives us an opportunity to plan ahead and stay in line with all the trends. So we're very, very excited about how the space is shaping up and changing.
Thank you so much. So before I hand over to Sipho to close, I would just like to mention that we have been focusing on businesses in COVID crisis for the last year on these webinars with various topics. This one was absolutely incredible, and I'm sure you will inspire many people along the way. Thank you very much, gentlemen, and thank you, Tasneem, for taking time out of your busy schedule. And upcoming webinars will include looking at hospitality and tourism and how they can survive the COVID crisis, because I think out of everybody, they're probably really battling at the moment. So keep your eyes open. And then we also have a very exciting one coming up on youth development and education. So we have some awesome, awesome topics coming up. And feedback is key. Please, any topics you'd like us to cover or any questions, please, please, please keep giving us feedback. And with that, I will hand over to Sipho from the PBF to close for us. Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you, Tasneem. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, guests. And thank you, Sipho. I'm going to hand over to you now.
Thank you, Trish. Thank you, MEC Montara. Thank you, Ari and Paul, for the presentation. Our approach has always been the private-public partnership is critical in the growth of our economy. And we hope that this innovation will able to take us to the next level. In that note, let me, on behalf of the team, thanks to the team, such the organizers and everyone, thank, and those who are participating, our subscribers, thank you for participating. We'll also invite you in our future engagement. In that note, let me declare this engagement officially closed. Thank you.